Thank you, everybody, for coming back after the break. This section of the conference is going to be terribly exciting, as all of them. I just calculated the the combined H index of the next three speakers, and it is 350. So I don't think we have ever seen anything like that, three speakers in a row. No, not that anybody's counting. And one of the top authorities in the world on autophagy, Professor Ana Maria Cuervo, the Spanish-American scientist at Albert Einstein College of Medicine, is going to cover autophagy in aging and age-related disorders. So without further ado, Professor Cuervo, please take the floor.
Okay, so I'm sharing a screen. Can you see my slides?
Not yet. Yep, now we see the screen.
Okay, terrific.
And now we see the slides and you. Perfect.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, so really thank you, Maureen and Alex, for this tremendous opportunity. This is a one-in-a-kind meeting, and I have learned so much. So it's really a privilege to be here. And what I'm going to be talking is, of course, about autophagy. And we went into autophagy because of the relation with proteostasis. As you know, the components of the proteostasis machinery include chaperones and the UPS, but also autophagy. But as it was already pointed out this morning, I want to make the big shout out for autophagy, because it's not just limited to quality control of organelles and proteins, but it also has in very important roles in metabolic control at the systemic and cellular level, and almost in every other process that you want to include it. So beautiful work showing connections with senescence, with stemness, even with epigenetic regulation. So this is, I think, is important, because when we start thinking on modulating or doing something positive for autophagy, hopefully will have an impact in many other pillars of aging. And also, although we have these gorgeous talks about autophagy already through the morning, I just wanted to include this summary slide to highlight that we've been hearing a lot about this process of delivering of content to lysosomes through this vesicular components that is called macroautophagy, and that it has all these different flavors, and we have great talks on mitophagy already. But this is not the only way in which cells can do autophagy. We know that cells can just invaginate the membrane of lysosomes or endosomes and do this endosomal or microautophagy in general to degrade materials. And also they can transport proteins one by one across the lysosomal membrane from degradation through this process that is known as chaperone-mediated autophagy, or CMA for short. And that's actually the one that I'm gonna completely focus today in my talk, but I will be happy to entertain questions about what we are doing on the other pathways. So in this case of CMA, as I mentioned, only proteins can be degraded, and only those ones containing a targeting motif related to this pentapeptide. And last year we developed a free software that is accessible through this publication, and you can identify or look for your favorite protein and see if it has these motifs, because as I say, they are degenerated and they can be modified in different ways. And this motif is important because it's gonna be recognized by HSC70, the chaperone that is gonna target the protein to lysosomes. And in lysosomes, the major player for CMA is actually this LAMP2A, this lysosomal associated membrane protein, single span, that it serves as a receptor for this pathway. So when the substrates are identified by the chaperone, they bind to this LAMP2A receptor that now multimerize to create a translocation complex, and then the proteins get translocated and degraded inside. Through the years, we have learned a lot about this regulation of CMA, and I'm not gonna go into details, but we know that there are many players that locate directly at the lysosomal membrane to modulate this assembly and deassembly and translocation. There are also signaling pathways from the nucleus, from the plasma membrane, but also even organelles can signal into CMA. So we found that a mitochondria, for example, can signal to activate CMA under particular conditions. So something that we think is going to contribute to improve our understanding of the physiological role of this pathway has been the developing of this transgenic mouse model, where we have put an artificial reporter that, when it goes to lysosomes through CMA, highlight them. So then you start seeing this change of lysosomes as this fluorescent pattern. And this model was developed in collaboration with Esperanza Arias. And thanks to the collaboration with Jose Bravo Cordero, an amazing image expert in Mount Sinai, we were able to finally see the activation of CMA in different conditions. I've been saying for years that CMA is activated in the liver with starvation. But once you see this change from PANTA, from these fed conditions to a star, is when you really realize this is true and there is beautiful activation. And the beauty of this is that we can also now start understanding how cells inside an organ respond to different stimuli. So for example, this is kidney, fat on the left, starf on the right. And as you can see, the glomeruli couldn't care less about the starvation, no change in CMA, but look at the proximal tubules. They are massively activating CMA. So as I say, this is gonna give us an idea of how CMA change in response to different stressors. But also, of course, it has provided a very valuable tool to start analyzing the changes with age in the activity of this pathway, something that using biochemical analysis we did a while ago. And now, thanks to this model, Aurora Escrivo in the lab is being characterizing in her case, for example, different regions of the brain. And as you can see here, the anti pattern becomes a diffuse pattern at different ages in different parts of the brain. So we think that by completing this, we'll have better idea of what are the key areas where CMA decrease and how that associate to disease vulnerability. But something that I think we are very convinced now is that this decrease in CMA is quite universal. The timing might be different, as you saw in Aurora's data, but the end is always a decrease. And among the many players, the most important one that seems to be responsible for the decrease is this decrease in LAMP2A, the major key protein shown here in two different areas of the brain. So once we knew this was one of the players that decrease with age and is responsible for the reduction of CMA, we start questioning what are the consequences. I might be very excited about this pathway, but maybe it's not so important when you lose it with age, and also how that can affect age-related disorders. So to understand that better, what we developed was a knockout animal model where we basically eliminate or mimic the changes in CMA in a young animal model by taking out LAMP2A. And the first one developed was actually by Jamie Snyder, a former MSTP in the lab, developed a hepatocyte specific. And then of course we have started developing tissue specific ones. And the idea why we have now this nice collection of tissue specific is because it has helped us to understand what is the role of CMA in each of these organs. So something that we have learned is that as any other component of the proteostasis machinery, in almost all the organs, CMA contribute to quality control and replenishment of amino acids. But something that seems very unique for CMA is the ability to contribute to remodel the proteome. And I'm gonna pause here just to emphasize that even we always think about autophagy or CMA taking out damaged proteins, in the case of CMA, you can eliminate fully functional proteins just to terminate their function. So you basically can modulate many cellular processes. For example, these are metabolic pathways. These are enzymes that has been shown to at some point to be degraded by CMA in order to terminate the function that they have in these pathways. And the same is true for other cellular process, transcription, cell cycle, you name it. So I think this is an important role of this pathway in modulating different functions inside the cell in addition of the control of protein quality control. So just to illustrate with one example of these knockouts, this is a specific knockout in neurons, and this has been really complete a study by Mathieu Bordeaux. And as you can see here, the wild type is in the top, the knockout is at the bottom, and they already developed by 6 months. They have behavioral manifestations. In collaboration with Dave Salzer, we were able to show that actually this is because of loss of function of these neurons, as you can see here by the, in this case, dopamine recordings. And then when we look, how is proteostasis on the brain of these animals? Sure enough, if you look in the top is wild type animals, in the bottom are animals that are young. They don't have any toxic protein. But when you start looking at these prone to aggregate proteins like tau, alpha-synuclein, they start accumulating and actually they even form aggregates. So we thought that this is important because that means that proteins that were functional all of a sudden are in disaggregate and they cannot be modulated in the way that happens in the normal brain. So Mathieu has been looking at what are these proteins that appear in this aggregate. And of course, as you can see here, there seem to be different cluster groups. And I'm just showing you one to show that these metabolic enzymes that we already knew were substrates for CMA are now trapped in disaggregate, meaning that they are gonna lose the function that they normally have in regulating, in this case, neuronal metabolism. So we think that for all the phenotypes that we are seeing, part of the component is because of this loss of quality control and increase in proteotoxicity. And actually in the case of the brain, quality control cannot be compensated. So the loss of CMA ends with proteotoxicity. But in addition, you have a loss of function that is more related to these proteins that normally are regulated by this pathway ending in the aggregates. And then this is more related with the CMA related toxicity or the loss of function associated to loss of CMA. As I say, in the brain, you cannot compensate for loss of CMA and you have proteotoxicity. In the case of other organs, proteotoxicity is not so evident because other autophagy pathways take over, but you still have this loss of the ability to regulate important functions. So for example, in the case of the liver, we showed that CMA is important for the switch off of glycolysis or lipogenesis and to modulate glucose and lipid metabolism. Susmita in her adipose specific is showing us that the switch here is from use of carbohydrates to really store them in the form of lipids. And Luisa in her mouse skeletal muscle specific is showing also connections with regulation of metabolism, but by controlling the enzymatic load of the mitochondria. So this is again, functions that are more related to the loss of regulatory activities of CMA in the cell. So when you put this together, and this is just to summarize what we have done with many other collaborators, if you reduce CMA in a young animal, they start developing signs of degeneration, signs of metabolic disruption or metabolic syndrome, loss of stemness, and even higher incidence to cancer. So what can we do about this? So of course we have used, or we are currently engaged in a three-arm approach. We want to obtain genetic proof of concept that restoring or maintaining normal CMA is something good for you. We have to move to drugs, to do it with drugs eventually. And of course, we also want to know the impact of dietary interventions on modulation of CMA. But for today, I will just show you some evidence of how are we modulating genetically CMA. So if you remember, we mentioned that the levels of LAMP2A are maintained more or less constant, and then by midlife, they start going down. So Immata said, developed this animal model in our lab in which she can activate an extra copy of the this LAMP2A only when the endogenous start going down. So basically you are preserving the function of CMA, and these animals have never seen a decrease. And then of course, she also tried to see what happened if you restore it later on. So for sake of time, I'm gonna show you data in these very old animals comparing animals that have functional CMA through life and regular wild types. And the knock-ins, or the ones that have enhanced, maintained CMA through life are always in orange. So when we look at the lifespan, as you can see here, both males and females have a very pronounced increase in mouse lifespan, not only maximum, but also mean lifespan that we're excited about and we're still crunching data. So these curves might even be improved later on. And then in collaboration with Rafa de Cabo, we were able to do this frailty test. And when you do the 32 markers, you can see that they really have reduced lifespan, reduced frailty. And it's interesting because in some cases, they are independent of gender. So males and females both benefit of this intervention. For particular traits, there might be more beneficial effect in females or in males. But overall, the frailty index is clearly reducing those animals. Just to give you some functional data, we look at metabolism. So as you can see here in orange again are the ones that have preserved CMA and they have more efficient energy expenditure. We also did metabolomics with Angelo D'Alessandro. You're restoring the metabolomic profile. So in of the changes with age. We have done some things with preserved CMA, they function better. And to know that this was really at the level of the function of the neurons, not just of, because all the other metabolic improvement in these animals. With Pablo de Castillo, we did studies for LTP. And as you can see here, when we do recorders in not all animals, you really see this decrease or these alterations in the LTP that will lead to altered excitability. And we were hoping for our animals, all animals, to be in the middle, and they completely overlap with the young animals, suggesting that indeed we are restoring neuronal function. So when you put all this together, I have also the at the tissue level. So the tissue level, you can look here, for example, fibrosis, and you can see that in the liver, fibrosis increase with age, but not in our animals. Again, in heart, fibrosis increase with age. Again, not in animals with restored CMA. And out of the many cellular markers, I choose to show you senescent, because I know that we talked yesterday a lot about that. And as you can see here, when you compare all control animals' levels of senescent cells in these three tissues with the ones in our animals same age, they really have a significant decrease also in these senescent cells. So when you put all together behavioral, functional, tissue, and even molecular that I didn't show you, and you look where things cluster. So all and young animals are here. And as you see, our all animals are really clustering with the young animals. And if we do heterozygous, we see a dose dependence. They are halfway there. So all this data showing that if you restore at least LAMP2A, if you prevent the decrease of LAMP2A, you have beneficial effects, the lifespan, functional tissues. And I didn't show you molecular, but we also prevent some of the molecular changes of aging. That kind of encourage us to say, what about instead of preventing, let's start developing drugs that we can enhance the activity of this pathway when it's already down. And this is really a strong partnership with Evris Gavasiotis, who has really been the one, the motor in all these studies. So with Evris, we developed for in vivo use the first CMA activators. And I'm just showing you here two examples. I remember PANTA means more activity, how impressive activation we get in peripheral tissues, but also in the brain. So of course we are engaging now in trying to see what happens if we start administering this in midlife with all animals. But we also want to know if we can do something beneficial already in conditions in which CMA is deteriorated in aging and age-related disorders. We are going through a whole battery of disorders, but I'm just gonna show you in the three last slides some of the studies that we are doing with the neurodegenerative models because of the interest on that topic. So we have shown in the past that in conditions of Parkinson, Alzheimer, Huntington, it seems like CMA is also compromised and this gets aggravated with aging. So Nadia and then really Mathieu now is bringing this to completion, have been analyzing in a model, for example, this triple transgenic animal model, that is a model of Alzheimer's disease, or at least it's a model of pathology of A, beta, and tau, but this is the presenilin-2 model. So this model is gradual, so it's slow, and it has the aging component, and that's why we like it. And what we decide is to really add these compounds when you already have symptomatology and when you already have aggregates. And if we do behavior of different types, so you have here the visual memory. So for example, the compound, the drug will be always in blue, and you see a very nice improve of visual memory, also anxiety, clasping, motor sensor. But then when you look at the brains of these animals, so in the top are vehicle, in the bottom are the animals treated with these drugs, and you see a dramatic decrease in the levels of aggregations, A-beta plaques, and hyperphosphorylated tau. And remember, these animals already have plaque by the time that we add the drug. So encouraged by this data, Mathieu decided to really go for it and say what happened in a much more aggressive model of disease. So for example, this PS19 model, it's a model of tauopathy. They lost synapses already by 3 months. And the idea was whether these molecules can still do something beneficial. So at the behavioral level, again, the drug is in blue. And as you can see here, you really improve the hyperlocomotion that is characteristic of these animals, but also look at the memory. So you can really restore or improve the memory in this group. And then when you look at the brain, and this is my most favorite image right now, you look at vehicle-treated animals and you can see all this tau pathology in this case, and look at the drug-treated animals. So we really think that, of course, this is still a mouse model, but we think that this is encouraging that by improving CMA activity, we might be able to clean up some of these brains. So just to sum up, I wanted to convey that when you think about autophagy and CMA in particular, it's not all about garbage accumulation, but it's also important that you lose key regulatory functions, and then you end with all these degenerative and metabolic conditions and disorders. And even it sounds very depressing because LAMP2A is going to decrease in all of us. We are now much more enthusiastic that we are working on really preventing that from happening. So not only the beautiful genetic models from IMA that shows that you can really prevent the decrease in the activity of this pathway, but also ERIS showing that these drugs can really act even in disease, we find it very encouraging. And then this is, of course, the most important slide. I have the luxury to work with a bunch of highly motivated and enthusiastic people. Can only mention a couple of them as I went. And I'm a lysosomal person who doesn't know about anything outside lysosomes. So nothing will be possible without all these terrific collaborators and the people who gave us the money. Thank you so much for your attention.
Ana Maria, such a beautiful talk. Thank you so much. I can tell you that Slack is now full of not only questions, but just mentions and basically exclamations of admiration. Which I also subscribe to. We don't have too much time for questions, but for you are one of the, again, top experts in autophagy in the world. There is a question from John Ferber. In humans, how many hours of fasting until CMA begins? And after CMA begins, how many hours of CMA is adequate for benefits? Just your best guess.
Yeah, so CMA activation regarding fasting, if you talk of fasting in general, start occurring by 6 to 8 hours and then just plateau. We have been able to do studies of until 3 days in the case of the animals, but more than general fasting, what we are learning a lot is that different metabolites regulate it different. So be careful with your sugars because high carbohydrate diets are going to have a very negative impact in this pathway. And also more than the amount of what you eat, going back to all that we've been hearing, the time at where you are eating is also very important. We know CMA is circadian, and we have a beautiful work coming on that. So I think you should start thinking, when do you eat and what you are eating? And as I said, different organs are going to activate it at different times. So hopefully we'll have much more coming on that soon.
And another quick question, very highly upvoted by Marco De Maria. So SA beta gal is a lysosomal enzyme. Could it be regulated by CMA independent of senescence?
Yeah, so that's a very good question, because before I even know about senescence, for us, beta gal is a lysosomal enzyme. I didn't know anything. I was like, why is these people using this beta gal for this? So actually it's an enzyme. What we know, and this I want to be very careful, because we talk about lysosomes, like, oh, lysosomes. There are many different populations of lysosomes. So what we know is, for example, the CMA lysosomes do not accumulate lipofuscin, because this happened mostly in the other type of lysosome. So there are variations on that. In general, enzymes, so CMA will degrade proteins that go to the cytosol. So if your beta gal is properly folded, it will go through vesicles and CMA shouldn't see it. But having said that, if it's not properly folded and it ends in the cytosol, there is still a chance of CMA contributing to quality control more than regulation in that case. But it's a really interesting question that we are looking into right now.
So, and the last question by Evandro Fang, who presented earlier. So he, again, admires your work and talked to you last year. He supports that the argument that defective autophagy, including defective mitophagy, can be an independent hallmark of aging. And the question is, how do cells balance autophagy and ubiquitin proteasome system in elimination of the trash, quote unquote?
Yeah, so well, the admiration for his work is also mutual here. And I think that he touched on a very important point, that because of time, we didn't go into that. when you study each of these types of autophagy and each of these components of the proteostasis machinery, the ubiquity in the chaperones, this all adds in coordination. And a big part of my lab is really interested in the crosstalk. It's like, when do you activate one? When do you activate the other? And then how do you decide who can compensate for what? So compensation is never perfect, but an interesting aspect here is that if you remember from the CMA targeting motif, there is very often a lysine there. And as you know, ubiquitinization in lysine, simulation, acetylation is really gonna contribute into the shift of whether you go to one pathway and the other. But I agree, very, very important question to have in mind, not only just like for the mechanistic of it, but also when you or us start chemically modulating autophagy in one organ or in a person, what is gonna happen to the other pathways? And it's something that we should really be careful and look into all those details.
Thank you, Ana Maria. Again, deeply honored to have you with us today. If possible, there are some other questions in Slack. If you are there, please do answer some of them because people are participating and again, admiring your work. Thank you so
Absolutely.
Much.
Thank you and congratulations on the meeting.
Thank you.